generations. May your love and peace reign in us, that we may glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever. Worthy to your kingdom and raise glory and thanks to you forever.
Hallelujah. of the gospel of our Savior, announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Apostle Matthew wrote, "The book of genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham became the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. Judah became the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Perez became the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Aminadab, Aminadab became the father of Nashon. Nashon became the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz became the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed became the father of Jesse, Jesse the father of David, the king. David became the father of Solomon, whose mother had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon became the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, Abijah the father of Asaph, Asaph became the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, Joram the father of Uzziah. Uzziah became the father of Jotam, Jotam became the father of Ahaz, Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah became the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amos, Amos the father of Josiah, Josiah became the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the Babylonian exile. After the Babylonian exile, Jeconiah became the father of Shealtiel. Shealtiel became the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, the father of Abiud. Abiud became the father of Eliakim. Eliakim, the father of Azor. Azor, the father of Zadok. Zadok became the father of Achim. Achim, the father of Eliud. Eliud, the father of Eleazar. Eleazar became the father of Matan. Matan, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Thus, the total number of generations from Abraham to David is 14 generations. From David to the Babylonian exile, 14 generations. From the Babylonian exile to the Messiah, 14 generations. This is the truth. Peace be with you. Should be an interesting weekend. What St. Matthew is doing in this gospel at the very beginning, of course, since by the Fathers, we know that St. Matthew's gospel is almost certainly the first of the four to be written in Hebrew or Aramaic. The first writings then of this line, this is the genealogy or the generation of Jesus Christ. It's why in the four Gospels and the symbolisms that we have the eagle represented by St. John, representing St. John in his theology. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, this sublime beginning to his Gospel. The sacrifice of our Lord, symbolized by St. Luke as an ox. And the genealogy that we have St. Mark preaching in the desert of St. John the Baptist. We have the lion. And St. Matthew is always represented by the four evangelists as the man. Because at the beginning of this genealogy, how it is that this child, Yehoshua, born of a virgin, is also the son of David. So last week, we considered the second half of this chapter. Now we consider the first week of this chapter by the genealogy. But the book begins by talking about the Agnesen. Agnesen, the beginning or the generation, the formation. And so what he's doing, last week we saw the adoption of St. Joseph, of this child. What he's doing here is why that adoption was so vitally important, that Joseph, who stood in awe, was overwhelmed by the majesty of the divine word coming into his home. Why it was necessary the angel appeared to him to encourage him and push him, as it were, towards accomplishing this adoption. It's the link with everything back to Abraham. Now we have two genealogies of our Lord. This one that we have in St. Matthew, and another one in the Gospel of St. Luke. In the Gospel of St. Luke, the genealogy is traced back to Adam. St. Luke is emphasizing the fact that this child who was born is the savior of the entire human race. What St. Matthew is doing for his converts, because they're Christians, but they're from a Jewish background. And so for them, the prophecies are important. But of course, for them, they link definitively the Messiah, specifically with the promises made to Abraham. So St. Matthew doesn't take the lineage all the way back to Adam. He takes it back to Abraham. And what he's done in this first chapter is he's stylized by breaking up the three great moments from Abraham, about the year 2000 BC, not to Moses and the law of Mount Sinai, because it's the accomplishment of the promises. He goes to David. David's about 300 years after Moses. So we go from Abraham to David, from about the year 2000 to about the year 1100, and then from the year 1100 to the Babylonian captivity that we have from David, which is about 600. And then we have the break from the Babylonian captivity to our Lord. So what St. Matthew is doing is he's stylizing to break down, to emphasize the number 14. 14 is a significant number for the Hebrews, because as we mentioned before, in the classical languages, and especially in the Semitic languages, but also in Greek, there are no numbers as we know them. They use the letters of the alphabet. So A being 1, B is 2. And so the notion of the name, when you wrote a name out in letters, it also had a numerical value. Because A is 1, B is 2, you just simply add up what the numbers were. It's where we get the Antichrist from that everyone gets obsessed with over 666. It's the way you figure out these numbers. So, what St. Matthew is doing is he's taking the numerical value of the name David. And the name David has the numerical value of 14. Because what St. Matthew is doing is insisting upon the fact that this is the royal king descendant of David, the Messiah who is born. There are two titles in these lists. No one else is called king in any of the listing, even though they were kings of Israel and of Judah, except David. And our Lord, the other title is, of course, Messiah, Christ. So everything in St. Matthew is focusing upon David and the fulfillment of the prophecies in this child born of Mary. So he uses 14. So he breaks down the generations to 14. One emphasizes number first because, in fact, there's obviously more men in these generations than just 14. They're not the same distance between each of these events from Abraham to David, David, Babylonian captivity, Babylon to the Christ. So for example, there is a period of time in this counting of the period between Abraham and David, a place where there's three names on the listing of 14. But those three names cover a period of 215 years. So some of the names have been dropped out to give us stylized 14, 14, and 14, but the last 14, in fact, are only 13 names. Because what St. Matthew is emphasizing is the 14th and the fulfillment, and the true David, 14, is this child, Yeshua, who is born of Maryam. And so this is the reason why he gives this genealogy. As I told you before, it was funny, because a few months ago someone said to me, Genealogy Sunday is so boring, because it's just a list of names. What is also fascinating about this list of names is that, of course, after the Babylonian captivity, other than the book of Maccabees, but there are no kings, we have no names. And so this is family archives that are given to us, put into the scriptures for the descent to Joseph. So what St. Matthew has done here then is to emphasize that this child who is born, and remember the people who are listening to the gospel already believe. What he is doing is elucidating and teaching further about who the Messiah is. So this is truly David who is born to this woman. This is the son of David, the accomplishment of the prophecies. This is the Messiah and the fulfillment of all the promises made to Abraham. This is the meaning of this book. So when we translate it as the genealogy of Jesus Christ, it's important to understand that what the word is really saying is the generation. How this child is also the Christ. It's not just giving us names of a list of grandfathers. The last thing I'd like you to note here is that there are a number of women, three or four women, who are mentioned in this listing. Which is interesting because normally we have no listing of women. If you read the Old Testament, and you have the breakdown when Israel in the north and Judea break away in the south after King Solomon, the kings of Israel are listed throughout the centuries of who these men are. But what is fascinating about Judea is not only do you list who the men are, you list the names of their mothers. But only in Judah. But of course in Judea, they are the descendants of David. And so there is a link, and in our Syriac spirituality and the understanding of the scriptures, those are types. By announcing the mother, they're announcing the types of who this woman, Maryam, who is married to Joseph, standing as a type of the true David, and her name is given as the mother of this child. But these women have another aspect to them, is that all of the women who are in this listing are all non-Israelites. They are Hittites, Moabites, they're from outside of the nation. They are not Israelites, they are essentially from pagan peoples. So that is already an aspect that St. Matthew has included their names to show us also the aspect of the redemption of the whole world. That this child is for the redemption and the salvation of all, not just Israel. But the promises of Abraham are to all. And the last point is to note that these women that are mentioned, because other women's names could have been mentioned, St. Matthew chooses the women with whom in the histories are all associated with some form of sexual immorality. Now, that seems unusual at first, but what St. Matthew is also pointing out is that this child who is born to Joseph and to Mary, that this child is for the healing of the wounded, of the remedy of sin, and of the elevation of those in sin to be bringing them towards the house of Shlomo. And so that importance of the listing of the men and the women in this listing to give the great importance. So that when he finishes and coming to Jacob, and Jacob is the father of Joseph, who is the husband of Mary, of whom is born Yeshua, who is called the Christ. That's the importance of what he's beginning. And then the rest of the gospel is developing how these promises of Abraham are to be fulfilled. And of course, finishing with our Lord's death and resurrection and the institution of the church to continue his work after that point. So hopefully, as we roll each year after year, genealogy comes, genealogy Sunday comes back. Hopefully in the future, we won't see it as being so boring. May the prayers of Saint Joseph, Father of our Lord, adopted Father of our Lord, intercede for us that we may have the same devotion and the same faith to follow and to see this fulfillment of the promises to Abraham. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Our brothers and sisters, both the living
living and the departed, especially those from the sacrifices offered for the repose of Mary Elias. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. Amen.
Show us.
cherubim bless you, and the seraphim worship you. They cry out and they proclaim. Thank you. and through you and with you in God your Father, saying,
Oh,
O Lord, you are the pleasing oblation.
Glorify yourself for us.
You are the living sacrifice.
Glorify yourself to your Father.
You are the high priest.
Glorify yourself as the Lamb.
Through your mercy,
become the everlasting righteousness,
which we offer to your Father through you.
To you be glory forever.
Did you know that your And the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.